question is, sir, it is for Ahuja, sir. Sir, could you confirm the condition for creating an HUF?
Let me tell you, HUF is not created by the act of parties. This is something myth which is already saying. The day the child is born, for income tax, there is HUF. For Hindu law, the day you get married, it is HUF. But since you need to have a co-partner for a new HUF, the day child is born. Now, even if a child is born, there is HUF, what is the meaning to the income tax? Income tax says, come to me when only there is income. Earlier there was a wealth tax also, come to me when you have to pay wealth tax. Now you got a money, so you need to have a money there, corpus there. The corpus will come from where? The corpus will be either by way of gift or by way of a will. Otherwise, I'm not saying there is any other act. The only thing is that HUF is already there the day you get married. But for income tax, the day you have a child, it is HUF already created. But if you want to go to income tax, you need to have funds, you need to have income, you need to have assets. So for that, of course, whenever you have income more than 250,000, you have to file a return of income. Without that, there is no need to file it. So absolutely no conditions. HUF is legal. I mean, it is not by act of parties. You cannot say, I will form HUF, I will not form HUF. From income tax point of view, you have funds, you have earned income, pay tax on that, you have no funds, you have no income. There is HUF as per Hindu law, but there is no HUF under income tax. So for filing income tax, for income tax purposes, you need to have funds and that you need to earn income from that funds for which you pay tax. Correct?
So sir, we can say the basic condition is marriage.
Basic condition, I would say, for Hindu law is marriage, for income tax, linear descendant.
So we have a second question.
I think you are not married.
No.
So no HUF. you can be a member of your father's HUF, not your own HUF. Okay. That's what he's asking.
Second question is from Mr. Raj. Sir, his question is, I'll narrate. If a charitable trust who is registered under Section 12A run a museum for public and also run commercial complex on the same land, can his income received as lease rent from commercial complex will be exempt under Section 12A if the trust spends 85% of his rental income for maintaining and running the museum?
My dear friend, you already know a charitable trust. What is a charity? What is the definition of charitable purpose? Section 2, clause 15 talks about charitable purpose. It says charitable purpose includes relief to the poor. Halaki ye yaha topic nahi hai, but since the question has been asked, I will definitely answer. Relief to the poor, education, yoga, medical relief, preservation of environment, including watershed, wildlife, forests, preservation of any monument or other places of historic or artistic interest, and advancement of any other object of general public utility. This is the definition given under Section 2, Clause 15. Your question, it appears, it is neither a relief to poor, nor education, nor yoga, nor preservation. If it is a preservation of monument or places of historic and artistic interest, it is different. Then you can do your commercial activity. But the last category, if you are registered under advancement of any other object of general public utility, there is a proviso which gives that, provided that advancement of any other object of general public utility shall not be called a charitable purpose if it involves in the activity of carrying on any trade, commerce, or any business, or for rendering any service to trade, commerce, or business, unless this is your main business and you are applying this for this business, and the gross receipt from that business does not exceed 20% of gross receipt. So the receipt from that business. So if the receipt from that business is more than 20% of gross receipts, let me tell you, they will not get exemption. They will not get exemption if there is a commercial activity and you are registered under advancement of general public utility. Please say to it, receipt from this commercial activity should not be more than 20% of your gross receipts. Otherwise, exemption will not be given.
So, moving forward to the discussion, sir, what is the key taxation? taxation issues in succession planning?
This question should have been asked earlier, but when I was sitting here, I just peeped into your paper. So I saw that you were going to ask me about succession planning also. This I didn't know. Otherwise, I said you should ask succession planning first. Okay, the titles. You know, we have Hindu law for Hindus, which is not a codified law. We have Muslim law for Muslims, which is also not a codified law. The codified law for Hindu in our country are two. One is for succession. Hindu Succession Act 1956 and Indian Succession Act 1955. What is the difference between Hindu Succession Act 1956 and Indian Succession 1925? If I die intestate, means without writing a will, Hindu Succession Act 1956 will apply. But if I write a will, registered or not registered, that is a secondary thing, Indian Succession Act 1925. There is a possibility that for a certain item, I write a will, for certain asset, I don't write. So for asset which I have written a will, Indian Succession Act 1925 applies. For the other item for which I have not written a will, Hindu Succession Act 1956 applies. What is this? I'll come to that. For Muslims, Sharia law. So there is a separate Sharia law for Shias, separate Sharia law for Sunnis. And one more thing, there is a law of Hindu in Sharia also. You cannot make a will for more than one third of your total asset in case of Muslims. There is a restriction. So two thirds has to be according to the Sharia law. For Jews, Christians, Parsis, or any other persons, what applies is only one act, Indian Succession Act 19. So this is first thing. Now for succession planning, for Hindus, I said two laws. Hindu Succession Act 1956, Indian Succession Act 1925. Let me take you to Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956. If I die intestate, if I die intestate, everybody has to die. And I don't write a will. Or write a will for certain items, the other assets I don't write. Please write to us, my property will go to my legal heir of class 1 in their individual capacity and in equal ratio. My assets, if I have not written will, will go to my legal heir of class 1, we can say class 1 category, and it goes in their individual capacity and equal ratio. Suppose there are class 1 legal heir are 2, 50. Class legal heir are, I'll tell you what is class 1 legal heir. Class 1 legal heir are 4, 25, 25, 25, 25. There is only one class 1 legal heir left, 100%. But please note, it goes in their individual capacity. You cannot form HUF in this case. So if I die, my son, he cannot form HUF. Unless I had given in a will that it will go to HMS. It will go to an individual capacity to my legal heir of the class 1. Wait. If there is no legal heir of the class 1, then it will go to the legal heir of class 2. In class 2, there are steps. Step number 1, only to 1%. Step number 2, horizontal, few persons. Step number 3, I'll tell you that. Class 2. Suppose there is no legal heir of class 1, there is no legal heir of class 2, then you will go to agnates. What do you mean by agnates? Agnates means father's relation. Because 1 is not there, 2 is not there, father, because father comes under 2, so father would take it. But if the father is also not there, so class 2 agnates. Agnates, that is agnates. If agnates are also not there, then you go to cognates. Cognates is mother relation. Mother also comes under class 1, but mother relation means a mother is not there, and first category not there, second category is not there, agnates are not there, two cognates. How interesting. So no one is there. I always say, wherever I say, what is in this world? It will go to government of India. It's called escheat. E-S-C-H-A-E-E-A-T. I again repeat. E-S-C-H-E-A-T, escheat. Escheat means where the state, the crown, takes back the property. Because no one is there, the crown will take back. Crown will be the central government. We take back the property if no one is there. So this is the a male Hindu nice. I'm not talking about a female Hindu, a male Hindu nice. This is succession planning, of course, without writing a will. So I have not written it. To whom it will go? My legal heir of first class. Who are they?
Will it go to the central government or to the president of India?
Ultimately, president of India is central government. Ultimately, the president of India is vested with him, but president doesn't hold it. It is held on behalf of central government. President holds it on behalf of central government. So it is ultimately of the government. Crown. I said crown. The crown is, of course, the government. Headed by the president of India. Headed by the president of India, but of course, crown. It goes to the crown. Here it is not crown, here it is the government, but that is the system. Coming back. So, what I was talking about, who are the legal heir of the first category? If I die intestate, to whom it will go? Number one, my wife. The legal heir, my wife. Number two, my sons. Son or sons. Number three, my daughter. Daughter or jitne bhi number hai, equal. Ek aur bhi legal heir, which people are not realizing. There is one more legal heir of the first category, that is mother. Please note the mother, whether dependent or independent. Father first category mein hi aata hai. Mother comes under the first category. So there are legal heir, wife, children. Children means both son and daughter, and mother. If mother is
very interesting, sir. We never thought that mother is a legal.
Mother is a legal heir. Mother is a legal heir. Mother is a legal heir. She is alive.
Father ne kya kasoor
kiya? Father ne kasoor nahi kiya. Father ne to paida kiya. Lekin father normally dependent nahi hote. Aur kuch nahi hai. Father hai there. Ye mother ke naam rakha. She to get more security for the woman. Security. So what I am trying to explain, please try to understand. I take an example. Wife, one son, one daughter, mother. You can have two sons. Let's say two sons, one. Let's say three nahi hone chahiye, do hi hone chahiye. Do se kam ho to jyada better hai aaj kal ke zamane mein. So let's say wife, son, daughter, mother. They're all alive. One fourth to wife, one fourth to son, one fourth to daughter, one fourth to the mother. This is equal ratio in their individual capacity. Please, no HUF. Next, if the mother is not alive, possible. My mother is not alive. Quite possible. Now, she will not get nothing. Legally, if she is alive, she gets it. If she is not alive, nothing will come. So, if she is not alive, one third to the wife, one third to the son, one third to the daughter. Mother is not there, so one third, one third, one third. If the mother had been there, one fourth, one fourth, one fourth, one. Next question. The wife is not alive. I lost my wife 2 years back. So, wife is not alive. Whatever it is, this is our God willing, what can I do? If the wife is not alive, it will go to my children. If I have two children, three children, one third, one third, one third. It will go to them in their individual capacity. If I had only one child, 100% would have gone. 100% would have gone. Wait. Phir main bol raha hu, kuch baatein sunne wali hai, first category complete nahi hua. I said, mother is not there, my children. Now there is a son, there is a daughter, unmarried. Alive? But let us say, God forbids, the son pre-diseases the father and he is not married. Son pre-diseases the father and he is not married. No shame. No shame. Daughter pre-diseases the father and there is no, she is not married. But suppose, there is no shame, but suppose the son is married and he pre-diseases the father. Dekhi, hum father ki property baat rahe hain, son ki nahi. Son pre-diseases the father. A father ki property kisko jayegi? The legal heir of the son in equal ratio. Who is the legal heir of the son? His wife and children. Wife and children. What amount? What would have been the share of the son? Had he been alive on that day? what would have been the share of the son had he been alive, that share will go to his legal heir in equal capacity. That is, his widow, wife, and his two, if they have two children in equal ratio. Suppose the son's share was 1/4 had he been alive. He dies, predeceases the father. So 1/4 would have gone to 1/12 to wife, 1/12 to son, 1/12 to his. This is predeceased daughter, and she's also married. She was married, she predeceases the father. Whatever had been the share of the daughter, had she been alive, would go to his children. To go to her children and not to the husband, to her children in equal ratio. Predeceased son of a predeceased. लंबी बात कर रहा हूं भगवान ना करे लेकिन जो भी है प्री डिजीज सन ऑफ ए प्री डिजीज सन अगर उसको जो शेयर मिलना था उसके लीगल हेयर को जाएगा इंडिविजुअल वही वाइफ एंड ये सब फर्स्ट कैटेगरी में लेकिन ये जो आ रहे हैं ना प्री डिजीज सन के लीगल हेयर या डॉटर के लीगल हेयर दे ओनली कम व्हेन द सन इज नॉट अलाइव सन प्री डिजीजेस और डॉटर प्री इफ द सन इज देयर That they don't have.
So grandchildren have no share in the.
Absolutely, grandchild pote ka apne grandfather ki property mein under Hindu succession act no right. Till his father is alive. His father is alive, the father. But if the father predeceases, then of course his legal heir, that is his wife and children. Right. This is one part. Now let's say no one is there in the category one. There is a son. Let us not talk about a son. There is a person, individual, not married. So that means he doesn't have wife, he doesn't have children, but he has mother. If he has mother, it will go to mother. But if he has no mother, then he is married. He is unmarried. And he dies, it is his property. I'm not talking father's property. It is his property and he dies. He's not married. Mother, the mother is not here. Second, I'll come to that. He was married and he dies. Children and wife, suppose they are not here. No children, wife also dies. Mother is also not here. Second category. So second category will come into picture only when there is no one from category one, class one. Now who comes into second? Three steps. First is 100% to father. 100%. Nobody will share. 100% to father. If that person was not married, he died 100% to father. I'm talking about Hindu male. Maybe female ka nahi baat kar raha. 100% to father. Married, but no legal heir of first category. Mean no children, no wife. They died before. One mother is not. The father is not there. Who will get it? Son's daughter's children. Please note the word. Son, daughter, children. And I say siblings. That is brother and sister. Equal aayega. Jitne son ke daughter children, daughter ke children, and let's say two children. Aur bhai bhi hai, behen bhi hai. To char hoga. Son's daughter children second category में आते हैं after father and साथ में कौन आता है that male brother and male sister siblings ये नहीं तो क्या होगा brothers children कौन है उसके भाई siblings, उनके children, वो नहीं है तो विडो जो स्टेप मदर मैं कह रहा हूं मदर तो ऊपर आ गई स्टेप मदर का नंबर यहां आ रहा है स्टेप मदर देखिए दोनों फादर और मदर दोनों स्टेप नहीं होते एक स्टेप होता है एक ही होता है तो स्टेप मदर यहां आएगी अगर वो नेचुरल मदर है तो उधर आती स्टेप मदर एंड विडोज ऑफ द सिबलिंग्स उनको आएगा इक्वल समझ में आगे चलना है
amazing how you remember
उसके बाद फादर स्पिरिट्स वो भी नहीं है तो फादर सिबलिंग अब उसके सिबलिंग नहीं फादर सिबलिंग वो भी नहीं है तो मदर पेरेंट्स वो भी नहीं है तो मदर सिबलिंग उसके आगे जाने की जरूरत नहीं है ये तो कॉग्निट्स के बाद चला जाओ या कॉग्निट्स के बाद दिस इज इट्स इनहेरिटेंस दिस इज विदाउट राइटिंग इट बट इफ आई राइट इट आई कैन गिव माय प्रॉपर्टी टू एनीवन इट्स नॉट नेसेसरी दैट शुड गिव माय चिल्ड्रन आई शुड गिव टू माय वाइफ आई गिव टू माय मदर एनीवन आई लाइक I can make a will. Will will take place only when after I die. You can get the will registered. You may not get the will registered. This doesn't make any difference. The will can be on a simple piece of paper. No need of a stamp paper. Space, write a will, put your signatures, and then have two witnesses. Two witnesses to see it. The witnesses are only signing that he has signed in my Witness may not know anything about the will. They may not know what is written, what are the contents of the will. They are only saying that this person has signed in my presence. उसके सामने sign है, दो witness उसके address वगैरह सब लिखे जाते हैं, he signed my presence. So tomorrow you will say witness does not the content. He may be told him. And witness in Hindu law, even beneficiary can also be witness. In Christian world that is not allowed. But Hindu law, the beneficiary can also be a witness because he's the person interested. He's getting the property, but still he can be a witness. The executor can also be a witness. So anybody can be a witness in Hindu law. But it's better here at that time. Because he will dispute, Harisha, if you don't give evenly to your members, could not put dispute will create. So to avoid that dispute, so that somebody may not say the will has been taken under undue influence, maybe under coercion, maybe by fraud, maybe whatever, maybe the reason you can always dispute the will. To defeat that, it cannot be 100% eliminated, but to defeat that, you can take a witness of a doctor. Doctor who can write that he is a person of sound mind. At least sound mind is also important. If he is of unsound mind, he cannot write a will. If he is intoxicated, he cannot write a will. So he will write, he is of sound mind. And secondly, to the chartered accountant, if possible, the lawyer if possible, because he'll say, I'll explain the contents of the will if he wants. But he has signed in my presence. I know he knows the implication of all that will. It is better always. But will is not 100% secure. I mean, it can always be disputed. You cannot say, my. So what I'm trying to say, will can be disputed. I mean, normally wills are disputed. But as far as possible, if everybody agrees, and if you have given a will in a judicious manner, so it is. But there are many advantages. One, when you have written a will and it is registered, it cannot be stolen. Because you can always go to the registrar and take out the copy of the will. It cannot be stolen. And it has more authenticity if it is registered. Authenticity means you had already planned, you have gone to there, you have taken they have taken a photograph of yours, they have put your signatures there, that means you were a sound mind and you have gone. So that also is authenticity. And three, for getting your property mutated in your name, a corporation may jaiye, so the will, it can be mutated in your name. So easy to get it, mutation. Yes, if you have to take a probate or a succession certificate, then there is a long procedure. But otherwise, will you can always do it. It is better to write it. At least immovable property. Other properties, of course, even a succession will also do. But you can have both the things. You can write a will for certain things. You may not write a will for this. You can do it. So these are the basic concepts which I wanted to tell you.
Thank you very much, Deva.